Hey everybody, it's Tech Tuesday. Today I'm going to be talking about IPv4 and what to do if you're an ISP and you're running out of IPv4 addresses. Step number one, don't panic. Hey, thanks for joining me. Again, Rick Uzi, Zcorum, and we're talking about IPv4 today. I wanted to say that if you want to chat, let me know that you're watching at any time. I don't know if I'll see it right when I'm talking to you, but I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have at the end, and we can have a little chat if you're live. So again, we're talking today about IPv4. So let's talk a little bit first about some history here. So why are we where we are today? Well, IPv4 was deployed back in January of 1983. So to give you a little perspective on that, how long that's been, AOL started their service in 1983. So that's America Online. And they were not an internet provider at that point. They were just an online service. So also, that was the year that Compaq shipped their first portable computer. Portable in the sense about 28 pounds, had 128K of RAM. It was about $3,500 at that time. It's about $7,500 today. So that gives you perspective of how long that's been. Now, at the time, or today even, there are 4.3 billion IPv4 addresses. So at that time, that seemed like plenty, right? Because the internet, when it started, it was just a few computers at universities, servers that were hooked up together. It was not everybody at the university, just the servers were hooked up together, and IPv4 was running that. And then in the mid-90s or so, when the internet became commercial, then obviously there was a lot more need for IPv4 addresses. And here we sit today with so many people online and so many devices out there, 7.5 billion people in the world, and only 4.3 billion IPv4 addresses. You can see why I have an issue, right? So IPv6 was developed, and it's been talked about for a lot of years, and we're at a point now where there's been pretty good acceptance of that. A lot of people have rolled that out. So why IPv6? Well, instead of 4.3 billion addresses, IPv6 has 360 undecillion addresses. Now, what is that? What's undecillion? An undecillion is a 1 followed by 36 zeros. That's a lot of anything. So there's 360 of those. So what does that practically mean as far as IPv6 addresses? That means, it's been said, that you could assign an IP address to every atom on the surface of the earth and have enough. So I think we're set for now. Of course, that's what they said about IPv4, so you never know. If we start assigning addresses to atoms, or maybe when Starfleet Command comes around, we start going to other planets, maybe we'll need more. But for right now, I think we're probably good with IPv6. And again, we've been hearing about it for a long time. Reminds me of the Y2K thing, if you remember that, where it's like, well, that was a defined date, right? So everybody thought on January 1st, 2000, the world was going to end. It was going to be chaos. Chaos. Didn't happen, okay? But IPv6 was similar. It's just that we didn't know exactly when, but we were going to run out of IPv4 addresses. And when that happened, chaos. Didn't happen, right? Well, for one thing, the date kept getting pushed back. And why is that? Well, more people started doing NAT, network address translation, in their local networks. So companies and homes and whatnot would have, you know, just a few public addresses, and everything else behind that would be NATed. And then also we started having addresses reclaimed that had been out there, because back in the early days you could they'd give you all the addresses you wanted, right? But that was not so much the case later. So there was no chaos. And another reason there's no chaos is because your customers, if you're an ISP and you're on an IPv4 network, then your customers can still reach IPv6 content out there that's been switched over. Because the IPv6 content, those people that are running websites and whatnot, they could not switch over to IPv6 without also supporting IPv4. Because obviously then there would be a lot of people that would not be able to get to their content. So they're making sure that they support both. As an ISP, you're okay as long as you've got enough IPv4 addresses for now, and really, you're going to need enough addresses to make it to the end of IPv4. And really, for all practical purposes, we are out of addresses now. You may not realize that. Maybe you have if you've tried to get some. But the regional internet registries, that would be ARIN for North America, APNIC for Asia, AFRINIC, Africa, obviously, LACNIC for Latin America and Caribbean, and then RIPE for Europe. those are regional internet registries that assign or were assigning the IP addresses that backbone providers would get, and large companies, when they would need addresses, they would get those. If you were smaller, you might get your IP addresses from your circuit provider. They'd give you a circuit, and then they give you a certain number of addresses with that. So, but the regional internet registries now have been out of addresses for a long time. So if you're an ISP, what do you do if you're running out of IPv4 addresses? Again, don't panic, but there are two basic options. And it's important that you need to know this, because if you run out of IPv4 addresses, you're not going to be able to get any more subscribers. So if you're wanting to grow your business, once you're out of IPv4, you can't grow your subscriber base, even if you try to switch over to IPv6, and I'll explain that in a minute. So one option right now, today, would be to buy IPv4 addresses. And that really hurts, because, again, you used to be able to get them for free. Right, so you get them, you've gotten a circuit, you get addresses, and Aaron was giving them out, and like, yeah, sure, you want 1,000 addresses, you want 100,000 addresses, whatever, because we had 4.3 billion, and we thought that was plenty. But they started getting cranky. When we started running out, when you wanted to get new addresses, they started making you justify them, like, why do you want these addresses? Do you really need these addresses? And then they started making you justify the addresses you already had, because, again, they were running out, and they were trying to postpone this need to switch everything over to IPv6 for as long as possible. So you can't get them today unless you go buy them. You can get them from a broker. They're expensive. Last time I checked, they were about $20 per address. That's been going up over time. So that's a lot of money. It's a temporary fix, most likely, unless you're going to buy a whole bunch. And because of that, it's probably not a good investment. You'll need to buy, basically, if you're going to have enough IPv4 addresses, you're going to have to buy enough to wait out the internet to make sure that it's all IPv6. And that's going to be a long time, if you think about it. So think about all of the web hosting companies out there, the little small web hosting companies, people that have web servers in their basement, or just companies that just have a web server. You just don't know when they're all going to be getting their act together to get switched over to IPv6. So if you did that today, let's take an example. Let's say you migrate. Let's say you want to migrate to IPv6, but you're not ready, and you're in a crunch, so you need to get some more. So you decide, well, I'll just go ahead and buy some addresses to get me through the next year. Maybe you buy a Class C, a /24. That's 256 addresses. So you buy that number of addresses to get you through the next year, and then in a year you get all of your equipment in place, and you say, well, I'm going to migrate now to IPv6. Well, you can't really do that. If you did. If you just switched, cut over to IPv6, then your customers are not going to be able to get to IPv4 content. So there are going to be websites out there, content out there, that it's going to be apparent pretty quickly when your customers can't get there. They're going to call you and say, I can't get there from here, and you're going to have a problem, right? So you're going to need enough IPv4 addresses to get you through to the point where we're basically off of IPv4. And then we just cut over to IPv6. And we don't know when that's going to be. We don't know how long it's going to take for all of the little places on the internet content to be IPv4. So that's an important point. So what are other ISPs doing? So if they already have secured enough IPv4 addresses, either they had them already or they've secured them for their anticipated growth, then they're going to try to wait it out and go to the end of that IPv4 content. They may be using carrier-grade NAT, which I'm going to talk about in a second, or they haven't done anything yet, which may be the situation that you're in. So basically, that's where people are right now. Some have cut over, and they've got enough addresses. Some are doing carrier-grade NAT, CGNAT. So what is CGNAT? Again, that's carrier-grade NAT. It basically uses network address translation, carrier-grade scale, to conserve the IPv4 addresses you have, and then it can also do translations between IPv4 and IPv6. But I think the biggest thing right now is conserving the addresses you have if you don't have enough. So with carrier grade NAT, you can oversubscribe one public address 30 times, or let's say 30, what is it, 32, 64, or 128, you know, somewhere in that range. And you can see how that would let you grow if you've got just a limited number of addresses now. That will greatly increase the number of addresses or number of subscribers that you can get just on the IPv4 addresses that you have today. And if you do need, if that's not going to be quite enough, you can buy a lot fewer addresses. And again, at $20 a piece, that can make a big difference. So if you needed to get, you know, one more slash 24, maybe that's $5,000, right, in today's market, that's going to probably last you forever, maybe, depending on how quickly you're growing and how big you are. So those are basically your two choices. Buy more addresses, get carrier grade NAT. You may be thinking, well, what about dual stack, Rick? I've heard about that. What's dual stack? Dual stack is where you as an ISP can run both IPv4 and IPv6 on your network, and therefore your customers can get to both IPv4 and IPv6 sites. The problem with that is it doesn't alleviate the IPv4 shortage. If you don't have enough .4 or IPv4 addresses, then you're still in the same boat, because with dual stack, you have to have both an IPv4 and an IPv6 address on at every subscriber. So that doesn't help. You would run dual stack when you have enough addresses. So unless you can buy enough addresses to the end of IPv4, CGNAT is going to be the better option, especially if you're thinking that you're going to maybe get dribs and drabs of IPv4 addresses here and there. So you go buy some, and then you're going to need some more, and then you go buy some. And basically what you need to do is look at your subscriber growth, your anticipated subscriber growth, and see what you think you're going to need. And then you need to take into account also possibly some Internet of Things kinds of applications. Now, right now, that's not that big a deal because, you know, you've got your doorbells and your cameras and your thermostats and, who knows, refrigerators and this and that stuff. Those things right now are generally NATed at the customer's router, so they're not using a public address. But there are going to be IoT applications that are going to be needing public addresses and not private addresses. So when that is the case, then you're going to see some additional need for IPv4 or just IP addresses in general. Now, once everything's over to IPv6, you can assign all the IP public addresses you want, because again, there's plenty. We don't see how we're going to run out theoretically. So that's the story. If this has been helpful, please go ahead and like our video. Go ahead and you can subscribe. Just click the subscribe button on the video. Click the thumbs up to like the video. If you want to know a little bit about CGNAT, more about that, just go to zcorum.com/CGNAT, and you'll see that right there. Next week, on the same topic, carrier grade NAT, what I'm going to be talking about with a guest is NAT64 and NAT44. Those are two of the flavors that we have when you're doing carrier grade NAT, and that it's dependent upon what type of network you have today and what you're trying to accomplish. So we're going to be talking about CGNAT again next week, and that would be NAT64 and NAT44. So I will see you then. Thanks. Bye-bye.